It is Ham Radio Now, episode 230 from the ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference 2015, October, Chicago, Illinois environment. And this one is, awkward a little bit. Not putting the title down here quite yet, because this is what you've been seeing here in the conference program for a while now. You know, every time I bring this up, you see this one. It's supposed to be ARDOP, the Amateur Radio Digital Open Protocol. And it turns out those guys didn't make it to the conference. Some communications mix up and they weren't there. Steve was still looking for them as the conference was opening up on Friday morning, and this was supposed to be Friday afternoon. So he had something in his back pocket. So now let's bring the thing through. Ham Radio Now, episode 230. Open source communications framework with James Bodie, G6FPC. This is going to be sort of a commercial for, because this is not ham radio, but it's interesting technology to hams. It's about cell phones and some of the stuff that goes behind into the networks, behind the scenes of how cell phone stuff gets put together. And I'm not sure how reasonable this is that James will propose, but he's saying that Tapper could become a cell phone network operator of some kind. That's what he says. Could happen. I don't think so, but I suppose it could happen. So a lot of detail, some of it sales pitch, but not all of it. And much of it, something they'd probably be interested in, if not purely for ham radio reasons, for understanding what goes on behind the scenes or behind the front panel of your cell phone. So we'll take a look at that in just a moment. I will remind you, speaking of sales pitches, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you're interested in any of these programs, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. Arvin will be glad to accept your contribution, either as a single contribution through PayPal. You don't need a PayPal account. PayPal is just my merchant service provider. You can use a PayPal account, but if you don't have one, you're not signing up for them. You're just doing the usual credit card thing. So either way, through PayPal. And the other thing is through Patreon. You can sign up for, you have to join Patreon, and you can contribute on a monthly basis, a buck or so, and keep sustaining Ham Radio Now. So we'd appreciate it either way. So let's go to Chicago and find out what this open source communications framework is all about. And Steve will tell you about his last minute search for a talk for Friday afternoon.
I kept mine. Okay, so as we're setting up for the next speaker, so we had an unexpected change, and then unexpected changes also give unexpected outcomes and challenges. So we have a gentleman that just happened to be in the area and dropped in on us, and I'd like to introduce, come on up here, James. This is James Bodie. G6FPC, and he happens to be in town for mobile phone.
Yeah, I've been here at a real-time communication conference at the Illinois Institute of Technology, and then I'm going on to Astricon down in Orlando, and just happened to be passing through this area today and saw that DCC was on, so I thought I'd pop in. Bumped into Steve, and within 30 seconds, he had me in an arm lock, demanding.
I've never done that before, have I?
Right up here.
Okay.
Forward and back.
So, as a good gentleman should, you always have a talk in your pocket, okay? And as we say, no good deed goes unpunished. And he's graciously agreed to give us a talk about this open source communications framework. Now, what's interesting is it's not exactly ham radio, but then again, we always like an out-of-the-box opportunity. Here is one, and let's see what James can inspire us to do for our project, shall we? What do you think?
Well, thank you for that. I've been a radio amateur for about 35, 36 years. I took my RAE in UK when I was an undergraduate at Queen Mary College, University of London. And we were all marched off as a form body to the Royal Horticultural Hall, and we all had to do the RAE, and woe betide anybody who failed, but luckily nobody did. Everything developed from there. I have since spent 22 years serving as an officer in the Royal Corps of Signals in the British Army. I went right the way up to the top of my tree and then fell out of it, then retired. But I wasn't retired for very long. I've got an expensive family to run and ended up working for a small and very specialised carrier based in Northamptonshire who supply the police, the Ministry of Defence, US DOD, and the security services. So that was a bit of fun. And then I bumped into somebody else. In fact, that somebody else that I bumped into was this gentleman here. This is the indomitable, one and only Mr. James Tagg, inventor of many things, amongst which is the capacitive LCD touchscreen. And there's a story behind that. It started off life as a radio modem for Scion handheld computers, but it was a total and utter failure because every time you brought your hand anywhere near it, the capacitive loading of your hand would put the thing into parasitic oscillation. So that was a complete disaster. But luckily, he's got a brain about the size of a planet. He managed to work out that he could do something else with it. The first iteration was a children's book, where you could sense where your finger was on the book, and then he threw that out and replaced it with an LCD screen, and the rest is history. He had to go through an 18-month patent battle here in the States, which he won. So luckily he's a multimillionaire, and I wouldn't want to work for anybody else. The outfit I work for is an outfit called Truphone. There were five of us. And we started off in James Tagg's cowshed on his organic farm back in 2006. The original plan was that we were called Software Cellular Network then. The original plan was that we were going to build innovative technical bits and pieces and flog them to mobile network operators. However, we very quickly found out that that was not a very clever idea because there are always lots of people who can think of really good reasons why you should not buy things that threaten their core existence. So that's when he came up with the cunning plan of becoming a mobile network operator ourselves. So we did. And the plan was we would eat our own dog food. And we were the original over-the-top operator. Lots of them now. So this is using mobile voice over IP over the top of Wi-Fi and data services. When we kicked off, we were using the original Nokia Symbian Series 60 Edition 3 phones, the original ones, which worked fine until the mobile network operators flagged us up as a threat, and they put a certain amount of pressure on Nokia to take that out, to take the voice over Wi-Fi out. Then we had to build our own clients. We have a certain amount of notoriety in that we were the very, very first people to put a SIP VoIP client on the iPhone, and we demonstrated that precisely 8 days after the jailbreak went live. And we demonstrated that in San Diego, California, under the nose of Apple. And as expected, 6.5 hours later, we had a cease and desist letter from Apple's legal department, which we immediately complied with. And to cut a long story short, as a direct result of that, we had one of the first 6 iPhone dev certs in Europe, which enabled us to have the one and only VoIP app in the iTunes App Store when it went live, which was great. But then we changed direction. James Tagg, brain the size of planet, may he live forever, decided that OTT was too easy. And if we're going to do things properly, we needed to control the full stack. So he said, you know what? We're going to become a mobile network operator, a proper one, but not just any mobile network operator. We're going to become a global mobile network operator. So I remember looking across the room thinking, this is sheer lunacy. This is impossible. But one thing about James Tagg, when he says he wants to do something, he really means it. And here we are 8.5 years later and a bit, and we've done it. We've got a global mobile network operation. We've picked up a CEO along the way, a chap called Steve Robertson, who was previously CEO of another tiny little UK startup called BT OpenReach. You may have heard of them. We're today, it says on the side here, about 550 strong. There's a bit of drama in there, of course. Just before Christmas, we were about 1,100 strong. But there was a problem with Russian oil rubles, which meant we had to go through a restructuring. So today, we're about 550 strong globally. At the moment, we sell reasonably conventional packages, but global packages, mainly into big businesses. So think international banking, avionics, aviation, sorry, oil industry. And then we've got the exciting people we sell into, like football teams, pop stars, and minor royalty, and Russian oligarchs. I think we've completely cornered the market in Russian oligarchs. That's an interesting slide. I've got no idea why I put that in. By the way, I hasten to add, this slide pack is one that I threw together in the early hours of the morning, earlier in this week. So I can't actually remember what's in it. So this is going to be as much a surprise for me as it is for you, I think. We've got some interesting customers. Does anybody here know who Iggy Azalea is? Because I had no idea. I'm impressed, sir.
I have a
17-year-old
daughter.
Yeah. Well, I've got a 16-year-old son. I had to get my 16-year-old son to show me a video of who Iggy Azalea was. And this video showed her in a swimsuit being sprayed with water with Rihanna. And that gives you some kind of idea. But anyway, she's a TruPhone customer. And she rather helpfully tweeted the front screen of her phone. So we've got lots of interesting customers. And the whole point of that is it kind of proves that the whole thing works. Because they're the sort of people, if it doesn't work, we know about it really, really very, very quickly. Let's talk about the technology. We've got a whole load of IPR in this area. One of the major areas of IPR is with this thing, the SIM card. These can be quite sophisticated little devices. Our SIM cards have got an ARM processor. It's a 300 meg ARM processor. We've got about just under 200 megs of usable RAM on there. We also utilize the signaling channel out of the back end as a covert channel, which is always on, of course, because it has to be always on, because that's how you authenticate. We run these as multi-IMSI devices. An IMSI being an international mobile subscriber identity. Normally, a SIM card will have one of these. We have lots of them. And the reason we do that is that it allows us to switch the IMSI as you go between different countries. We do that for two reasons. Firstly, it dramatically reduces the cost we pay to the other operators because we become local. Secondly, it allows us to use local infrastructure, which means the performance we get out of our network is much, much better. To illustrate that, if you had a normal UK SIM, you went to, say, Australia, and you're trying to surf an Australian website, all your data would go from your phone all the way back to UK to then come all the way back to Australia. And a certain amount of latency in there, which is kind of not good, but with one of ours, it thinks it's an Australian thing, and it terminates the data traffic through a local packet data network gateway, and we have blisteringly fast round trip times. We also have multiple telephone numbers, but note, IMSIs are not the same thing as telephone numbers. Normally, we have multiple IMSIs, one of which is active at any one time, and then we have multiple user profiles, and what we do is we map all of the user profiles onto the currently active IMSI. So that means that you can have lots of numbers available all at the same time. And when we get through to playtime, I'll give you a demonstration and we can play pick a number, any number game and see whether it works. Well, of course it will. And incidentally, you might guess that there are a number of people who claim to run multi-IMSI SIM cards, but there's only one team who've got happy, high-end customers, and that's us. Was that a bit commercial? Probably is. Now, this is definitely a commercial slide, I'll explain it anyway. So what we've got here, this graph is showing where the revenues for mobile network operators come from. The green bit at the bottom are the conventional revenues that come off things like telephone calls and SMS. As you can see, it's going down to nothing. So not a good business to be in right now. The red bit is data. Everybody wants lots and lots and lots of data, ever wanting more and more data. But the price has gone down, but on balance, the amount of money, the revenue that's generated has gone up slightly. So still a reasonably good business to be in, but only if you've got very, very fat pipes. The purple bit, M2M, the Internet of Things, it's becoming big, and it's going to be bigger still. So machine-generated traffic is going to drive a lot of revenue. But you know what? There's quite a few people getting into that now. So from our perspective, not the best area to be in. The bit that really interests me is this yellow bit at the top, which is all about applications. It's all the stuff that you can do if you have a mobile network and you can put applications on top of it. And surprise, surprise, that's where my focus as head of research and development is focused right now. There have been a number of APIs around. An API, your tapper, I don't need to tell you what an API is, do I? Well, I'll tell you, it's application program interface. It's how you plug into other systems. The GSMA, that's the industry body. I can't even remember what GSMA stands for. They've had an API for some years now. It's called One API, and guess what? It's useless. It doesn't do anything. You can do three things. You can generate a billing event with it. You can send an SMS message. Rock on. That's really good. And you can get some location information from it, perhaps on a good day. Then there's some identity stuff. The rich presence. OMA is another industry body. And they've got something called RCS, the Rich Communications Suite. This is all about messaging again and presence, mobile presence. But it's described by a good friend of mine, Dean Bubley, as a zombie technology in that it's dead, but it's not dead, and it pops out and kind of worries people now and then. It's not dead. People are still trying to sell RCS kits, but, I mean, it's next to useless. We've got some identity stuff, OpenID, OpenID Connect, but again, huge problems with that. And then some other people have got some APIs. There's one in particular from an outfit called Axiata in Asia. I'm looking for a glimmer of recognition on anybody's face. Nobody knows anything about that, so we'll move on. So what we've done, good old TruPhone, global mobile network, which incidentally is quite good. It works really well, and we've got real live customers on it doing good stuff, and they're, by and large, very, very happy. But we've got a problem in that we've got this huge, expensive network, and we're running at less than 5% capacity. So it's the old mobile network operator problem. How do you fill your network? Well, we've come up with a cunning plan, and our cunning plan is to build an open source API to allow other people who've got application platforms to plug into our network. And you can build some amazing things with it. And I'm going to tell you what they are. But before I do that, can I just tease you? Here's a thought. What if
tapper could become a mobile network operator, an amateur radio mobile network operator. Just think about that one for a second. And we'll come back to spectrum at the end. Don't worry. I've got the answer for that too. So there's everything you need to know. All of that lot is what we're making available as an API set. And there's loads of good stuff in there. If you're into real-time communications application stuff, and the conference that I've just come from is packed full of people like that, they were very excited about this, and they were bouncing up and down with joy. Anyway, let's talk about the sort of stuff that we can do. The basic stuff is on here. How do you get set up in the first place? Well, the first problem is you've got to get hold of one of these. And you know what? SIM cards are actually quite difficult to get hold of if you're not a mobile network operator. So I'm guessing that there are probably some people in here who've tried open source GSM using something like OpenBTS. Anybody here used OpenBTS? Michael, I'm impressed. Well, of course you will, won't you? HackRF, yeah. You're one of my heroes, by the way, Michael. You're one of the reasons why I'm here. I wouldn't have come if you weren't here. You know that. Anyway, one of the big problems, that's embarrassed him now. One of the problems you get if you're trying to do your own mobile network stuff is you just can't get the SIM cards. Or if you can get the SIM cards, you can't get the cryptographic key variables. Because rule one of mobile networks, never ever give your cryptographic key variables to anybody. Unless you're Gem Alto, but that's another story. Okay, so you can get SIM cards, you can activate them, you can put multiple numbers on there. We can do things like international mobile number portability. Yes, we can port numbers. Of course, we have to, because you can't sell into big business unless you can do that. Virtual APNs, now that's an interesting one. The APN is the access point. I'm looking at my glamorous assistant. What's the N stand for? Node, is it, or name? Oh, anyway, it's the bit you put in which determines where your data goes. How about if you could send all the mobile data from your SIM card into your own network? That'd be pretty cool, wouldn't it? And hey, we can do that for you. You can have your own private mobile VPN if you want. Wi-Fi calling. Good old Apple with iOS 8. Put I-WLAN, which is a 3GPP standard, in the iPhone. Cracking move, because as soon as they did it, of course, Android are following on behind. That means that you can do all of your GSM-y type stuff, but do it over Wi-Fi, or in fact, over any other radio network that you can get your hands on. That's useful. Multi-IMSI operation, we do that, of course. Alternative roaming provider, I'm not going to go because you're not mobile network operators, I won't go into the detail, but basically it means that you can pick up another operator's profile, you can take one of their IMSIs, push it into your SIM, and then you then get a service on their network. And there's a bit of argy-bargy with the crypto in the middle, but we can handle that, so that's okay. Billing as a service, oh, this is a bit commercial, isn't it? But yeah, we can do all of that. We can bill in near real time. This is important. Old style mobile networks have got this horrible system of settlement for international roaming, which can take 2-3 weeks to settle. That's no good. And consequently, the prices tend to be very high because they're just protecting themselves against the fraud stuff. Taxes. We do taxes, which if you're an international operator, you have to deal with. But you're not bothered about that because we're radio amateurs. Call by call authorization, yeah, we do that. Usage feed from the PCRF, that's the policy control and rating function. Call price notification. Yeah, we on our things, the price of a call varies depending on which radio segment you're on. And so when you look at your phone, it'll tell you how much the call will cost, depending on how you're connected. High usage, that's boring. Other things you can do, location-based stuff. And I know, Tapper, you love location stuff with all your APRS stuff. I know, because I did it too. I was one of those X25 APRS junkies once upon a time, a long time ago. So you can do things like querying location by country, time zone, area, and even precise coordinates. I bet you didn't know that there's an SS7 map query, that if you've got access to the SS7 map, you can send this query to your handset, and it will send you the precise GPS coordinates without you even knowing. I bet you didn't know that. So there we are. We can run a composite GMLC, Global Mobile Location Center, using all kinds of different means, cell-based, GPS, Wi-Fi positioning. We can even hook into the Google and Apple BlackBerry, and even, if anybody's got a Microsoft phone, Microsoft location-based services. I hope there's nobody from Microsoft here. We can do all kinds of things with location update triggers. As your phone is in the mobile network, as it moves around all the time, it's sending back location updates. And what we can do is we can harvest those, and we can use them to trigger all kinds of things. Location history, and all kinds of geo-operation. Yeah, we can do all of that. USSD and USSI. Anybody here know what USSD is? Bearing in mind that you're... Who do you work for, sir? You don't work for AT&T, do you? No, but you know what USSD is. Okay, USSD is unstructured supplementary service data. And USSI is the IMS, the modern, go faster version of the same thing. It's kind of like SMS, but it's not SMS in that, for one, it's free in most cases, and it's designed so that you can talk to application servers. So have you ever put in a star hash 60 hash type command, press the go button on your phone? Well, that's if you have, that's USSD. But the great thing about it is what we can do is we can make that available to you, the developers. So you can run your own little USSD service to configure things, set things off, and you know what? It's free. It doesn't cost you anything, which is pretty neat. And you can do things like pushing responses back to the front of the phone without touching the SMS store. All kinds of useful things that you can do with your mobile handset, which I bet you didn't know you could do. And of course it works on just about all devices, not just smartphones. You can have a little cheap and cheerful 2G phone, and USSD works fine. And in fact, the area in which USSD applications have really taken off is in Asia, where people have slightly less sophisticated phones, and they're doing all kinds of things like finding out the cricket scores in India and selling their vegetables before they go to market, that sort of thing, but just using USSD as a transport. And the phones don't even have to have an IP subsystem in it. It's really, really useful. Traffic routing. Yeah, we can do all kinds of things with both voice and messages. Here are some ideas. All the standard call control intelligent networking stuff. So you can make calls go here, there, and everywhere, pop them out on SIP VoIP or any other kind of VoIP-based bearer you want. You can go multi-party. You can conference with them. We'll make available to you private dial plans, so you can have your own two-digit or three-digit dial plans if you want. So, you can do things like controlling your repeaters, but then again, you probably want to do that using USSD. Smart CLI, what's that? CLI is the calling line ID. That's the number that you present forward when you make a call or send a message. If you've got multiple numbers, you can choose which CLI you present at which time. And I personally, I carry 8 different numbers in 8 different countries on my handset. So if I call Australia, it'll present an Australian number. I call US, I call Hong Kong. It'll present a Hong Kong number, or US, a US number. And then people in US call me back on my US number. They like that. Something I've noticed is that people in US really don't like calling international numbers. They do anything rather than call an international number. Why is that? Global superpower? Yeah, funny that, isn't it? Okay, and we can fork record. We can do recording. Oh, something else I didn't say. We always force ourselves into the media path. So we can do things with analyzing the media. An example, emotional analysis is something we've been playing with in the lab. Imagine the scenario. You have one voicemail message from your wife, and she was angry. Yeah, potentially quite useful, that. All kinds of things you can do with it. But there are other fun things you can do, like changing your voice, perhaps, or just all kinds of things. Oh, and then, of course, multi-ring. You can have multiple endpoints on your account. So you can, depending on where you are, you can ring different ones, or you can ring them all at once if you want. I've got certain numbers, which if you hit one of these numbers, all my devices, and I normally carry about a dozen, they all go off at the same time. And somebody found this off, and about 2 years ago, I was giving a speaking slot, and the naughty little chap hit that number. Don't worry, I got him back later. But and UE-dependent routing. UE is the user equipment. It's the phone. So you can route depending on what sort of capabilities your device has. SMS messaging. Whoa, this is a good one. One big thing that we do, and most other mobile network operators don't do, is we force all messages to be home routed. That means we force the messages to come through our infrastructure so that we can get our little fingers in them. We can record them. And what it means is we can then push messages out to lots of different devices, and we can keep a record of it. It's a bit like the difference between POP3 email and IMAP. And IMAP, you keep a copy of the messages on the server. Well, we kind of do that. Yeah, we do all of that. Yeah, and we can do multiple messaging transports as well. That's a good one. So that wasn't me. So we can deliver messages using different transports. So the hot one at the moment is probably iMessage, is one of the hot ones. So rather than pushing an SMS over the SMS transport, we could push it over iMessage, which means you don't pay for it. Now, authentication as a service, I really, really like this one. This is a cracker. We have a complete suite of authentication, very high-end authentication capabilities, based on the stuff that's in here and the stuff that's in our back end. And what we can do is we can offer that as a service to third-party application platforms. It's great. I'm watching Michael's face, and he's thinking quite hard now. I like that. That's good. And as an extra bonus, this is about, 5 years ago, I decided to put multiple sets of cryptographic key variables in this little baby, which means that with one single OTA command, we can completely re-roll the SIM card. That is very cool. And I'm not going to talk about that. Oh, yeah, one of our little tricks that we might do in the future, which is related to authentication, is we can put a web server on the SIM card. And there are lots of things you can do with that. But I think, how are we doing for time? Is anybody timing me? Do you care? Okay. I'm going to stop there, because I did have more slides, but I ran out of time earlier this week to put them up there. So I'll leave you with a thought, and that is, the one thing that's stopping radio amateurs, two things that are stopping radio amateurs from becoming mobile network operators. Number one is spectrum. All of the usable spectrum for normal devices is held by the mobile network operators. But hey, I've got some good news for you. Globally, there's going to be a whole load of license-free spectrum opened up in the very, very near future. That's in the top end of 5 gigs, so mixing it in there with 802s or 11ac. And then there's another chunk in the 3.5, 3.6 gig band, and you're probably going, hey, the FCC have taken our 3.5 gig band away. Well, that's why, because it's going to become license-free for mobile. So how would you like to put your own mobile network, radio access network bits, into the 3.5 and 5.0 gig band? That'd be great, wouldn't it? And the other thing that is really empowering this whole movement is the stuff that Michael's doing, software-defined radios. If you go wind the clock back about 2 or 3 years, the cost of an E-Node B, that's an LTE base station, a little tiny one, would cost you about between $3,000 and $4,000. But today, thanks to the work of the software-defined radio guys, and Michael, we're not worthy. You're a superstar. The cost has come down to about $100. So all of a sudden, running your own mobile network is feasible. You can do it. Yes, you can do it, guys. And then there's the other little thing that you need, and that's a full member of the GSMA, a friendly mobile network operator, to do the back-end stuff for you and to give you SIM cards. And hello, I'm here. So there we are, guys. There's a challenge for you. Tapper, let's build a mobile network. What do you think? Questions?
What's your call sign, sir?
Oh, God, here we go. And this is the NSA, is it? No. I'm Golf 6, Foxtrot, Papa, Charlie. Also, Delta Alpha 1, Bravo Yankee. Okay, Royal Signals Amateur Radio Society 1754. Honorary life member. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Is it live? Hey, that's insulting. You say I'm from AT&T.
Who do you work for, then?
Alcatel, Lucent, Nokia.
Oh, my God.
So I've actually been involved in wireless for some time. But just understanding. So in Europe, you're an actual facilities-based operator? Are you?
Yeah, we're full member of the GSMA.
No, I mean, are you like MVNO everywhere?
Well, actually, we don't really fit any of the common definitions.
Okay.
So in 99.5% of scenarios, we are what would be coined a very heavy MVNO. What that means is we have all of the bits that you would normally expect to find in a mobile network, plus more, apart from the radio access network. But having said that, we own a couple of mobile networks, including one here in the USA, in Montana. And when certain operators get a bit kind of yap, 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 and they say, oh, you're only an MVNO. So, well, I've got a special slide, and I say, here's a picture of one of our masts in Montana, and I think that it's bigger than any that you've got in Luxembourg. So,
I think I might know that one. The question I was going to ask here, since you're doing this in the U.S., and I noticed you have real-time billing and charging and all that stuff, and I'm assuming all you're doing is mostly prepaid.
In fact, when we started off doing prepaid, and we were flogging SIM cards on all the usual airlines, so BA, Virgin, BMI, mm-hmm. EasyJet, Qantas, you name it. But you know what? We weren't making very much money on that, so we gave that up. So we now do post-pay, and our focus today is on large corporates and Russian oligarchs.
Okay, so this may be less of a question than I know here in the U.S. that the issue... at least at the time I was doing this. So I used to work for Altel, which I want to talk to you about that Montana thing. I think that's related. I was wondering, since you're European-based, do you guys even worry about Freedom Wireless, or is that a thing anymore?
We're global. We're not UK-based. We're global.
Well, I didn't know if you had to license that here in the U.S. with Freedom Wireless.
No, no, we've got a U.S. entity. We have,
okay.
We have you don't want to go into this, but we've got a really interesting corporate structure with lots of little bits all over the world, and they all report in, and, it's...
Yeah, FYI, for guys here, Freedom Wireless is this company that's came up with a patent on prepaid calling. It was horrible. Anyways, I dealt with them a bit.
Yeah, I think the future for us... is that what we want to do is to engineer out the cost of calling and the cost of traffic altogether. And the main reason for that is today it costs more to bill for it than it does to terminate it. So you just want to engineer that out. So I think going forward, we'll be charging for a bundle of functionality, applications, and then we just give away the traffic for free. You like that, don't you? That's a good one. And we can make a healthy living out of that. And the reason we're not bothered about it is because everybody's so busy these days, you don't actually have very much call time to make lots of calls. So we reckon we're quids in on that one. Right, more questions. Young gentleman at the back.
Thank you. Years ago, there was a decline in new radio amateurs that was attributed to the widespread availability of low-cost cell phones. And also, this has been given as a reason why many amateur radio licenses were allowed to expire when they could have easily been renewed. The excuse was all these people are now talking on their cell phone. And I'm intrigued by your idea of an amateur radio organization, such as perhaps Tapper, becoming a cellular operator. This might be a means by which there could be a hook to recapture a large segment of the general population as becoming and remaining radio amateurs.
I think you're right. And if you're going to do an analysis of the bands, probably the ones to look for are the TDD bands. So bands 37, 38, 39, 40. And I have a kind of feeling in the back of my head that at least one of those overlaps some amateur radio band somewhere. And so the great thing about them, you probably know the answer to this.
Actually, here in the US, we have the 33 centimeter amateur band, 900 megahertz. That overlaps perfectly with the 900 megahertz Wi-Fi band or cellular band you have in the rest of the world.
Okay, which then gives us the answer to the spectrum problem. So what's the difference between running cellular and something like fast scan TV? Not a lot, to be perfectly honest, I don't think. Is there? The only problem with an amateur radio mobile network, you wouldn't be able to charge money for calls and things like that, but you're not bothered because, hey, we're radio amateurs. So, and you're right, sir. I think that being able to build your own mobile network would bring lots of youngsters in. Don't you?
I do, but I feel that as I walk out the door, people might try and clobber me. Quick follow-up question. I'm currently using a backup cell phone from another British firm. It's what's called an e-kit phone. And can you explain how your product differs from the e-kit product?
Yeah, we don't make phones at all. Our hardware is this. And we just pop our platform into anybody else's phone. And as long as you've got access to any kind of radio access network somewhere, we'll try our best to make use of it. And you know, we're not that picky. We'll use Wi-Fi as well as 2G, 3G, LTE. We'll use anything we can get our hands on, including amateur bands, given half a chance. Okay, am I going to get off without...
Any other questions?
And to think, I'm only doing this because I walked in and said, I've just walked in, and Steve said, you can talk. thanks for that, Steve. I have to say...
Can he talk? Yeah. Can he talk?
Is Steve good? He is very, very good, this man.
Now I want to be a cell phone provider. No, not really. That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. I'm Gary Pierce, Scan4IQ. Thank you for watching. Once again, if you're so inclined, stop by hamradionow.tv. Help us out financially. Appreciate it. Didn't quite make the Kickstarter this year, so I went anyway, shot all this stuff anyway, and kind of hoping that you will make up the difference here on the back end. And a lot of you have. Just need a few more of you to do it. Hamradionow.tv. Did I say I'm Gary Pierce? I still am. 73. Over and out.